The Catholics of Oz is brought to you by the StarQuest Production Network and is made possible by our many generous patrons. If you'd like to support the podcast, please visit sqpn.com/give.
You're listening to episode 36 of The Catholics of Oz. The Catholics of Oz is a show where we discuss faith, culture, and what's been happening from an Aussie perspective. Whether it's synods or science, apostolates and apps, providence or productivity, you can hear it right now on The Catholics of Oz. Hello and welcome to episode 36 of The Catholics of Oz. My name is Lindsay Sand, your host for our show. And this is a really exciting one, but before I tell you why it's exciting, I'd like to start by introducing my lovely, wonderful, superior sister, Caroline Knight. Caroline, how are you?
Well, now that you've said that, thanks, Lindsay.
And our co-host for today, our good friend, Lino Sabol. Lino, how are you?
I'm good. Where's the intro for me for that band? What's going on?
Well, for Caroline, it's contractual. For you, it's optional. So.
I'm an optional guy. What's going on here? I'm good, Lindsay.
Excellent. And we are very, very excited because we have a special guest this evening on our show, Archbishop Peter Comensoli, the Archbishop of the Archdiocese of Melbourne. Welcome to the show.
Oh, hello, Lindsay. Hello, Caroline. Hello, Lino. And hello, everyone listening. Rather good. You know why I'm here.
Why are you here, Archbishop Peter?
Because in one of your other podcasts, you're going, we've got to get that dude on our program. And so I said, oh, well, okay, why not?
Yeah, we're very happy here. And yeah, we do blame Lino for this because Lino was the one, I think, who got the conversation started. So, because you were a topic in one of our episodes. And I think Lino was saying, yeah, we'd love to get to know him more and we'd love to have him on the show. And this is great because this is exactly what we want to do with today's episode as well. So before we continue, we'd just like to remind everyone to remember to like the Catholics of Oz on the SQPN Facebook page. Don't forget to retweet our episodes on Twitter and to leave us comments as well. You can subscribe to the show on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Stitcher, TuneIn, or your favorite podcast app. And SQPN has its own YouTube channel, so you can go there and listen to all the shows that SQPN produces on YouTube. Just hit the bell to get notifications when new episodes come out. You can also please leave us feedback and a lovely 5-star review on Apple Podcasts or any other podcast directory because this helps us to grow the show and to reach more people. So let's get into it. Archbishop Peter, Caroline and I actually wanted to talk about a connection that we have to you. So talking about 6 degrees of separation.
Caroline, I'm locked in bacon.
Yeah, a bit like that. Yeah. So, Caroline, do you want to tell the story of this one?
Okay. So, we have our auntie, Sister Miriam, is in Port Kembla, and she is the head sister there at the Sacred Heart of Jesus, the Franciscan sisters there, and we have an idea that perhaps you know her.
Do I know Sister Miriam or what? Yeah, I didn't realize the connection. Which is
yes.
Lovely. It's their feast day today, of course.
Yes.
It's the Sacred Heart of Jesus feast day today. And the lovely Franciscan sisters of the Sacred Heart. Sister Mary is a great, great woman. Great, great woman of God. And so I've known her for many years now. And we, in a funny sort of way, we sort of grew up together as she as a religious and me as a priest. You know, I don't know exact age, but, you know, we're not too different in age. And yeah, there you go.
We didn't even know that you knew her so well.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's funny. So can you please
I've got stories about her for you.
Oh, we want to know everything. We can tell you some things too. She comes and stays with us every summer, so.
Oh, good on her. Oh, that's good. Hopefully we'll be able to catch up this summer if she comes.
You know what? Let's organise it. We'll do it.
Yeah, yep. I think she'd love that. Yes.
She would love it. Would you please send out a little hello for her on this podcast? You know, I think she'll be...
Hi, Sister Miriam.
She was so happy.
Hey. So, Sister Miriam, I'm actually doing this via Zoom, so I'm actually waving. really weird seeing a podcast has no visuals. But anyway, great. I hope you're doing well. I got to see you very briefly. I remember it, Father Graham's... 50th anniversary celebrations, and so I hope you're doing well.
Thank you so much for that. She'll be very excited. We know that she listens, so she'll be very excited about that. Yes, and we'll try and organise a visit this summer when she comes for a visit.
Well, the borders between Victoria and Sydney are open, so we'll be able to do that.
Yeah.
That's right. We very nice and exchange our viruses with one another.
We do.
So, Archbishop Peter, we wanted to start with just some basic things. So it's almost 2 years, I think, now you're being the Archbishop of Melbourne. Is that correct?
That's right. 1st of August, 2018.
Of course, yeah. So we thought we'd start with some simple things. So you've been in Melbourne for a while, and I'm assuming by now you've adopted an AFL football team.
Hey.
And would you care to reveal to us what that team?
I adopted an AFL football team before I even got there.
Wow.
And I did so by way of, see if you can guess it once I give you a bit of information. So when it was first announced I was going to be Archbishop of Melbourne, yeah, lots of people were writing saying congratulations, welcome, and so on. So I know nothing. I knew nothing about Victoria or Melbourne. I'd only been to Melbourne a few times just to visit, so don't know anyone or didn't know anyone then. So lots of people were writing and saying, welcome. Typical Victorians. the second sentence, after welcome was, now you need to pick a footy team.
Oh, totally.
Of course.
Third sentence was, this is the footy team you need to pick.
Oh, wow. Yay.
And the fourth sentence was, whatever you do, don't go for.
That was very Victorian.
So I ended up choosing that team that no one told me not to go for.
That's a hard one.
And this might help. And I believe in redemption.
Oh,
yes.
Yes. Lino, this is sounding familiar. Do you want to take the first guess, Lino?
It wouldn't be the Essendon Football Club, would it, Archbishop?
The Dons.
Yeah, good word. Yes, all right.
Total redemption, Archbishop. Yes. Total redemption.
Indeed,
yes.
And at least we've started reasonably well so far, this return of the comp. Let's see how we go this weekend.
Yeah,
that's true. That is true.
And with that choice, you're welcome to come back on the show anytime.
I haven't given up on my first love, which is rugby league, but I still sort of hold my little candle down here to a little bit of rugby league.
Yes, that's how you should.
Who do you barrack for in New South Wales?
The best team, of course. Manly?
Oh, you're not a Rabbitohs, are you? No.
No
Rabbitohs. No, okay.
waste of effort.
Goodness me. Is this Catholics of Wales or is this on Triple M on the football footy?
it's different when you talk about sport, isn't it? All the rivalries come out.
I'm a very good Catholic. You need to be able to give expression to a position.
Exactly.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. So, tell us when you've got a bit of spare time, like you might have after this show. If you do you ever put your feet up and watch your television shows or anything on a streaming service? Is there anything that's your go-to at the moment?
Oh yeah. I've always I like watching movies. So if I get a night off or something, I wouldn't mind watching. Even if I might be working. You have a bit of a movie going on in the background, something like that. That all happens. I only got into streaming pretty recently, but got it on the Netflix. And last summer, I have my holidays in January. So
awesome.
Last January, I did a binge, my first binge in my life.
Wow.
Oh, well done. Welcome to the club.
And it was Stranger Things.
Oh yeah!
Oh yeah! It's great. It's a great show. Yeah. It's a great show, Archbishop. So, yeah.
So anyway, that's that. But now I watch all sorts of things. I don't get a lot of time for watching TV, but at the moment, if I can get a chance, I'll certainly on a Sunday night see who's getting eliminated from MasterChef.
I thought you were going to say Big Brother. Oh,
oh no, Caroline, no. Oh,
Caroline's a tragic. Yeah, Caroline's a tragic.
A bit
yes.
tragic. But I watch Big Brother and then watch MasterChef the following day. So I equalise it in a little bit.
Well, no, you don't really. But...
we can all have an opinion on that. My husband loves Big Brother. I'm outing him, but he loves it.
Weirdest show.
It really
show.
Is. It's a bit out there. Yeah,
it's almost as bad as watching Gogglebox, as far as
I know. Okay, I don't go there, no. Oh. Not that bad.
Yeah.
Now, I have to ask, because all of us are fans of this particular franchise, but would you happen to be a Star Wars fan at all?
Ah, yes. Now, I'm of an age, unlike you youngies, I'm of an age when the first... as in number four mm-hmm. in the series now.
Yes.
The first Star Wars movie came out when I was a teenager. So 78, I was, what will I have been? I would have been in about year eight, I think. All right. School, wow. Around about there. Yeah. So, cool. You know, I'm it.
Excellent.
So I was there from the beginning. One, two, and three weren't worth bothering about.
They were a bit awkward, yeah.
Yeah, they were a bit awkward, yeah, really.
Yeah.
4, 5, 6, brilliant. Yeah. 7, 8, 9, yeah, not too bad. Not too bad, actually.
That's good. I think we're in agreement with you.
Yeah, we're on the same page here. Yeah. Excellent. And tell us about some of your musical interests as well. What would you listen to if you had some time to throw some music on?
Oh, very, very strongly classical music. So I'm actually, I was classically trained on the violin.
Awesome.
So music-wise... though, you know, I'm fairly eclectic in all sorts of things. Being again my generation, anything 80s Aussie rock is good. But basically classical. And I love, I have no idea who your listeners are, but Jean Sibelius is one of my favourite composers. He was a Finnish composer, but brilliant. Anyway, lovely. There you go.
Yeah, no, that's great. And so we also wanted to, again, we said that this show was about finding out more about you. So I was wondering if you could tell us a bit about how it was that you ended up as a Catholic priest. And then eventually, I know that you had you were Bishop of Broken Bay for a while before becoming the Archbishop of Melbourne. And I know it's a broad question, but really, your spiritual journey, how is it that you found God calling you to the priesthood?
I think you've just sort of said the word that matters. God found me. Mm. God got me.
Yeah.
God got me. I wasn't, went through primary and secondary school. Our family was a good, solid, basic Catholic family, so we went to Mass on a Sunday, but there wasn't, huge amounts of, we weren't a deeply pious family or anything like that, but a genuine Catholic family.
Sure.
Dad, mum and dad were in Vinnies and those sorts of things, and my own background was just fairly normal in terms of all of that. We had some priests and religious in the family in various parts of the family, so it wasn't anything unusual for me to in that regard. My auntie was a nun, my cousin was a priest, but it was never pushed or anything like that. But it was something that sort of came to me when I was in about year 10. The first ideas of, I went to a high school where at that stage there were still priests in the on the staff. So I saw these fellows and they were pretty good. They were Mara's fathers, right. Mara's fathers, and they were pretty good. And so I thought I liked their life and was interested. Year 10, though, I'm much more interested in pursuing other pursuits of mm-hmm. possibilities.
Sure.
So, women and girls were more of interest in those days.
When you want to come in and say anything,
I'm not coming any further on that. But yeah, you know, normal sort of life, in other words, as most. But the idea of being a priest never went away. And, you know, I went through high school, worked for a number of years. I was studying at uni part-time. But it was just always there, sort of tipping away at me, tick, tick, tick. And to a point, I got to a point where I got actually sick of it. I got sick of this thing of, you know, God just wouldn't leave me alone. And then I sort of went into the seminary to get it out of my system.
Fair enough.
In a funny little way.
Yeah.
You know, let's go in there, you know, get it over and done with, get on with life. Well, so much for that.
That's why, look what happened.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I say God got me.
Yeah.
It wasn't me, you know, initially me running after the Lord, but somehow he came tapping. Yeah. And thanks be to God that he did for me.
Yeah.
I remember on my ordination day, on the day I became a priest back in 1992, that'll show you how old I am. none of you were born, probably.
No comments.
High school for us.
We want to stay friends.
I like those comments, though.
I'll just live with it. So I remember on the day of my ordination, I'd seen other people being ordained and, you know, great elation and, oh, I'm a priest. I never had that feeling. What I had was a sense of this is right.
Mm.
I just, on the day of ordination, yeah, this is right. Nice. And that's kind of remained with me ever since. That doesn't mean that I haven't had my ups and downs. I certainly have. And there's been some really rough periods and, you know, you make bad decisions at times, and you do some things well, you do some things bad, and so on. You like all of us in our faith, we go through dry periods or periods where we're, you know, serious doubt or struggle or whatever. All of that's part of my life.
Yeah.
Part of everyone's life. And it's part of being part of a priesthood as well. But it's that basic sense of peace around this is where the Lord wants me has remained.
Right.
And that's the case now.
Yeah, that's beautiful. And at any point while you were a priest, did you think someone's going to tap me on the shoulder and say, hey, we need you to be a bishop? Or how does that happen?
How does it happen? I need a drink to answer this one. how does it happen? I mean, there's the technical answer to how it happens.
Sure.
There's no sort of career path to becoming a bishop.
Yeah.
Not at all. You don't sort of get like in a career of if you're moving up, you would, you know, do certain lots of training. You'd be working with people to try and develop your skills and so on. So it's not like that. Remembering that a bishop is named after the successors of the apostles.
Yes.
An apostle is someone who's sent. It's not someone who chooses and goes, I'm going to do this. It's someone else who does the tapping and say, you go.
Yes.
So the process goes on behind the scenes. So the person who's actually chosen doesn't really know that this is happening about them. And I'm telling you all the technical details, because I'm about to let you know a bit of a secret. he's revealing something for the whole world. the process normally, and this is still the case, that there's a very serious examination of the person, but the person themselves usually not aware of that's happening.
Right.
So, for instance, at the moment, where I'm going through the process of getting four new auxiliary bishops for Melbourne, we need four. I've submitted a list of names to the nuncio, who's the ambassador of the Vatican in Australia. Those names are known to me. They're known to the nuncio. He does a process of searching, around about those. So getting in touch with people who may know that person.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes, and find there's a lot of confidential testing out of the various names.
It's like a reference those, almost, isn't it, Archbishop?
No, much more so than that. This is a seeking to examine someone's life.
Right.
Not just their, you know, are they capable, but how do they live their life?
How do they live their life? So, exactly.
Yeah. Mm. So it's all sorts of people are asked. Sometimes people think that, you know, only other bishops are asked, and it's a little bit of a club we're choosing for ourselves. That's not the case.
Right.
No, yeah. It's really important that
people
say, not the case.
Not the case.
Lay people are asked, other priests and religious, other bishops and so on. So it's a mixture of people who are asked. And then that information is examined and, you know, trying to look at, you know, what's needed in this particular diocese at any one particular time, what sort of bishops are needed at this time. All of that goes into the mix. And a few names are sent to Rome. There's another process of examination in that level, and then a decision is made by the Pope.
You would have been under the microscope then when your name was submitted, I guess, then as well. So people would have been doing a bit of background and trying to work out more about you and if you were right for the role.
Here's where the bit of inside knowledge comes that I'm about to share with you. Someone who received a letter about me hinted that they'd received a letter about me.
Oh, right.
Oh. Well, the surprise.
Yeah. Oh, what?
You heard it right here on Catholic Survivors, everyone. there's our exclusive.
Wasn't our auntie, was it?
No. So it was. I was overseas in Scotland studying at the time, and this person had said, maybe there's a letter, maybe there's something happening, and then nothing happened for 6 months.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh yeah, okay, you know, it's all gone. And at the time, it really rattled me. It's not a thing, to be honest, it really is not a thing that you're looking for.
Sure.
Or at least the sort of people you need as bishops are not the ones that are trying to be bishops. So it rattled me at the time, and I was I was getting towards the end of doing my doctorate, and, you know, it's a pretty intense thing writing doctorates.
This kind of spooked
me for a number of weeks. But as the time went on, it was 6 months, nothing happened. Finished the doctorate, came back to Australia, and I was a couple of months back in Australia when the phone call came.
Right.
Wow. Lucky you'd finished the doctorate, otherwise you'd be severely distracted. You wouldn't be able to finish it. Good timing.
So anyway, I can't say, hand on heart, I can't say that I didn't know this was a possibility. Certainly you don't know it's going to happen because a number of names are looked at the same time and three names are always sent to Rome.
Yep.
And so, anyway, here I am.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Blame the Pope.
Yes. Well, actually, so
thank him.
Yes. Yeah. We should thank him. Yeah.
Thank
that's
him.
Right.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Yeah. So, no, let's blame the current Pope.
Yeah.
Melbourne is Francis. Becoming a bishop was Benedict.
Benedict, right.
We'll thank them both. Yeah. There you go.
They both
made good decisions.
Yeah. Now, so we were curious about this. Have you actually met Pope Francis before?
Yes, I've met him a few times now. I had met him, if anyone's ever seen any images of his general audiences on a Wednesday, you normally see a row of bishops sitting along the front. And at the end of it, he comes along and shakes their hands, you know, hello. Just really is just like that. So he has no idea who you are. And that's it. So I had one or two of those sort of things. But I then got asked to attend and be a participant in the Synod for Young People. September, was it September, October? I can't remember now. Of 2018. I'd just been appointed Archbishop of Melbourne. And then the Pope says, well, come over to Rome and come to the Synod. So I wasn't
you're working.
That.
Yeah.
Straight away.
Put you on the job straight away.
Hello, I'm here. So in that experience, the Pope's there every day. and you're seeing him every day, and you're actually starting to have conversations with him, me and my very, very bad Italian, and so on. Even to the point, I must admit this, another little secret, I didn't do these things.
This is good.
Oh, we're enjoying this. Jesus. Yeah, this is great.
You know, there's a lot of
big
people,
brother.
I wouldn't go any good at that. The center is full of, you know, bishops and other people from all over the world. Lots of people to get to know and interesting to people. So over a month, if you're seeing someone every day, you don't always necessarily want to talk to them. towards the end of the time, you know, I'd walk past him, you know, hi, and go to somebody else and do something else. I'm like, yeah.
That's funny.
he is a genuinely beautiful man, a really genuine man of God, deeply prayerful, deeply committed to thinking through what it is to live the life of the gospel.
Yes.
And to find ways of doing that. Like every other human being, he's going to have his strengths and weaknesses.
Yep.
You know, that's all of us. Thanks be to God, we got Pope Francis. I was thinking, Carolyn, that yes, your work, the work that you're involved in, you know, very close to the heart of Pope Francis, as you know, through Laudato Si.
And the fifth
anniversary of that came up this past week.
That's right. Yes, it was recently. Yes.
So
it's not just an environmental encyclical. It's something about the way in which we are meant to be within and a part of and living in this world.
Yeah. We did read that together, and we did a little bit of a podcast on it a long time ago.
When
it came out.
Yeah.
And yeah, it did strike a chord with us, and yeah, it was good to have that environmental point of view, like that involvement in a document, you know, like that for everyone. And it's good that he highlighted that, you know, we're one with the earth, not one with the earth, but, you know, we need to take care of it.
It's our common home.
You know,
And putting forward a sense of an integral ecology, that it's not just about the physical world. It's not just about, you know, keeping the oceans good and, you know, the plant life and the animal life going. There's a human ecology part of this. So how we together are a part of this. So anyway, I just thought of that as we were just talking.
On Pope Francis, I was just saying, trying to say before, just for those who are listening, we had a bit of a glitch, but we're all fixed now. we were really moved by the Ubi et Orbi that Pope Francis did recently during the coronavirus, praying for everyone who was suffering and praying for people who were working to alleviate it as well. That was a really powerful moment in his papacy, one that he probably wasn't expecting either to happen. But did you manage to watch that live or watch it a little bit later on?
I didn't watch it live. I just slept instead.
Oh, me too. Me too. Don't worry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Watch it later.
Very early.
Same here.
It was very early. Yes.
Yes, it was. Yes.
So I did watch it though. One of the most powerful and remains for me an image and words that he shared with us and a disposition.
Yeah.
Into the coronavirus.
Yeah.
So how are we to be here?
Yeah.
So if every moment in our lives are moments of where the providence of God is working, then coronavirus is meant to be.
Yes.
And because this is a moment of revelation, a moment of grace, even in the midst of what is and has been, if you're looking at the world context, absolutely terrible. You know, the extent of loss of life,
and
livelihoods here in our own country, the livelihoods mainly. But so What is our disposition into this? What might we say? What might we do? How might we receive? All of those sorts of things are part of this. And the image of Pope Francis and the words that he spoke on that evening, I think remain deeply important.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, it was a really powerful moment. Let's talk about coronavirus for a moment.
Archbishop, I don't have it.
Okay, that's why we're on Zoom just in case, but it's all right.
Like it doesn't transmit electronically.
Yeah. So far, yeah.
But who knows? Yeah.
I guess, you know, as a nobody expects a pandemic, but here we are in the midst of a global pandemic now. How does it change how we are as a church in this particular time? We've seen all kinds of priests, you know, wonderfully innovating and doing things like streaming masses and even you streaming on Channel 31, the Sunday masses. But we're seeing all these changes. But how are we called to respond to global pandemics or anything? How has the church changed in this time?
Yeah. Lindsay, can I challenge the word change?
Sure.
It seems to be a language that is being used by many, many, most people, I suppose.
Yes.
But during this time, that this has been a, you know, world changing, life changing moment. And certainly there's been any amount of change going on. I've got no doubt about that.
Yep.
But the word that strikes me as the one that is most important is that coronavirus has been a revealing time.
Mm.
It reveals something about us, about how individually, how it's revealed to me something of how I am in terms of my relations with others, in terms of what is important and so on. And I think we can say that for everyone.
Yes.
So, We change and adapt all the time. Most of the time it's in small and incremental and not obvious ways. Certainly coronavirus has brought about very significant change, particularly in the Western context.
Yeah.
It's interesting that we don't talk about the African continent much when we talk about coronavirus. It's happening as much. But as someone said to me, in the African context, in many of the countries in Africa, what we are experiencing as something that's entirely disruptive to our life is not uncommon for them.
Mm. Wow. Oh, wow.
We would do well to look to our African brothers and sisters in various countries of Africa as to how one might be disposed to working through a time of great disruption and suffering and difficulty, if this is a pathway that others in the world are making and have been making all along.
It's very true.
Let's not get focused in on ourselves so much.
So true. Yeah. I think it's easy to do that, especially with the media. I find it's like how it's affecting everybody, and it's a focus on the person. But I think too, in the Western world, we're very comfortable in the way we live, and any disruption just totally rattles us. We just have this set way of living. We don't know how to adapt.
So I
find I'm seeing that in a lot of people as well. A lot of anxiety with, you know.
The other thing I think this time has revealed to me is that the extent to which our culture has a very shallow horizon.
Yes.
We've sort of shrunk our horizons to the immediate, to, you know, the satisfaction of now, of of wanting to stand on a position as it stands right now.
Mm-hmm.
And we've lost something of the sight, or this has revealed that perhaps we've lost something of a broader and deeper and longer horizon. I'm particularly struck by this in terms of the protests that have recently happened.
Yes,
absolutely nothing wrong with the reasons, or at least the proper reasons.
Yes.
But it does strike me that there was this extraordinary reaction, but it seems to have dissipated almost immediately. So there was something of a performative now aspect of it.
Yeah.
But what about the deeper questions of, in our context, the deeper questions of how we might recognize and uphold and honor the First Peoples of our nation?
Yes, that's true. How that might all work.
So it's all well and good to be and needed, and I don't want to in any way suggest that this was a bad thing that we should be standing up, but it was somewhat reactionary.
Yes.
Wow. Yes.
Reactionary. So and our horizons have been shrunk such that we react now, we perform now.
Yeah.
The protest itself is a performative action.
Yeah.
But where's the depth of the day-to-day commitment to this and and the ongoing struggle to resolve these sort of deep questions?
Of course. But
where's our horizons? Our horizons have shrunk.
Yes.
One of the things that our Christian faith offers us is a chance to expand our horizons if it's grappled with well.
Yeah,
exactly.
I think one thing we're good at understanding as Catholics is that it's the long haul, isn't it? And we're in it for the long haul.
The faith
experience isn't a reactionary thing. It's a journey.
It's a journey.
And that's an important thing I think for us to think about in terms of reconciliation. Our society's been talking about reconciliation for a while now, but we still haven't quite got there yet. We're still looking at statistics that that are not things for us to be proud of, I guess, in terms of our Indigenous brothers and sisters. Let's shift topic a little bit. So we know that actually last night when we were recording this podcast that you participated, talking about another social issue now, you participated in the St. Vincent de Paul's CEO sleepout. And from my understanding, this is where leaders of companies and leaders of big groups and leaders of churches will sleep out. Now, traditionally, I think in the past, they've actually slept in stadiums or in other places, but this year was a little bit different. Was this your first CEO sleep out? And how was the experience for you?
Yes, it was my first time, though it's been going for 14 years. You kind of got to get invited. I hadn't been invited before.
You're important now.
You have to know the right people, yeah.
That may not be quite accurate. You may not. You can probably invite yourself, but anyway. About 6 months ago, someone from St. Vincent de Paul down here said, you know, why don't you do it? And I said, yeah, sure, not a problem. Cool. So I registered then. Because of COVID, it was done in a different way. So rather than being in sort of a common area with a number of other people, it was you could do it in your backyard, you could do it in on a couch, or you could do it in your car. I did it in my car.
Yep.
So I did it in my car last night. And it was fine, a little bit of discomfort. Nothing wrong with a little bit of discomfort if you're doing it for a greater good.
Yes,
that's true. That's true.
So there was some. For me, the greater aspect of this is for me personally was the awareness raising. But it's also was a fundraising opportunity to actually go out to those that the work that Vinny's does to go out to those most in need who are broken and struggling in our society. So I was actually looking just tonight. They've raised over $5 million.
Excellent.
Wow, that's excellent.
That's great.
Already.
That's
pretty good.
Awesome.
And if anyone's listening and wants to put it in a donation, do it. I'd encourage it.
Yes. In fact, what we'll do is I'll find the details for that and put it in our show notes for this, so if people would like to follow up. But I think it's binnies.org.au from memory, their website. I've actually gone there a couple of times.
Yes, the place to donate for is ceosleepout.org.au.
Great, thank you for that. Yes, so we'd like to encourage anyone to donate. That's a great cause. So I've had a little bit of experience with people who experience homelessness because through my work as a teacher. So we've taken groups of students out to, there's a CYC retreat center in the city. And so we did a homelessness experience. So we took them to this retreat site. We would do sessions and we'd have people from Vinnies and others speak to our students. And then the students would go out during the day into the city to experience, again, different workshops. But obviously, they would be meeting people who were experiencing homelessness at the time. Yeah. And the change in our students was really interesting, and seeing how they their hearts of generosity opened up, that, you know, they were giving away their lunch and they were sitting down and having conversations with people and telling us, you know, this is things that we didn't actually tell them that they needed to do. So they'd gone above and beyond. What are you learning about homelessness and issues related to that in the city of Melbourne?
A few things I'd say. When I first arrived, I was quite taken aback of just how many people are sleeping rough.
Yes.
In the centre of our city.
Yes.
That's true.
I came from Sydney. It's a big metropolitan city as well. And there's plenty of people who are, you know, struggling and in really difficult situations there. But it was just more obvious to me. It was quite striking, actually. So that just anecdotally, I'm not saying that, you know, poverty or the causes of that are better or worse in our city than say other cities.
Sure.
But there was an obviousness that I hadn't experienced before, at least not in Australia. Certainly in other parts of the world, which I've been in, I've seen extraordinary poverty. Anyway, so there's that. I think in our own circumstances here in various parts of Melbourne, affordable housing and emergency and just basic housing that might be available for people when they find themselves out of home or they need to escape because of violence and or for whatever reason that's going on. Yeah. There's a need, a real genuine need to be working in that area. I think our local communities, the work that can be done to support people. One of my priorities in the Archdiocese is around family and marriage and family. And one of the dimensions of family life that we are noticing, we being, I think, our society is noticing, is on the increase, is the extent of domestic violence in our communities.
Is that because of the coronavirus as well?
Oh, well, coronavirus might have made it worse.
Or is it
perhaps. I go back to what I said earlier on about coronavirus reveals things.
Yes.
Mm, yes.
Here's an example of that. Mm. It reveals.
Yeah.
You don't suddenly become violent when you haven't been before.
Mm.
True.
Certainly, circumstances can bring out something that might be latent or something like that. So, what can we do to build up our family such that not only that we need to do things now for those who are right now needing our assistance, our call as God's people to charity, to go out to the poor. Blessed are the poor.
Yes.
Mm. So it says St. Luke in his version of the Beatitudes. Mm-hmm. Blessed are the poor in spirit as well in Matthew's version. And, you know, how do we build up our, so not only do the work of care right now in the image of, St. Mother Teresa, mm-hmm. you know, right now we need to do something, or in our own St. Mary McKillop see a need and do something about it.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
But what can we do is also to build up our capacities within our families to avoid this becoming an issue.
Yeah.
So there's both going on there.
Yeah, that sounds like a really important long-term project to work on, I guess, as well. Like you said, with the immediate need, but then also this building up of families over time in the archdiocese, the whole country, but yeah, especially where you see that need as well. Speaking of the archdiocese, so I know that you've made it your mission to visit every parish in the Archdiocese of Melbourne, and I think there are over 200, and I think you were doing okay until the coronavirus.
Yeah,
again.
Yeah. I was doing okay. Yeah.
So, can you at least
screaming halt?
Yes. Yeah. No choice there, but apart from, can you give us a bit of an update to the point where it had to stop? But how many parishes roughly do you think you were visited? Was it once a week? And what were you getting as a sense of the Catholic community in Melbourne?
Yeah. So, firstly, how many? I don't know. It's 60, 70, 80, somewhere around about there. I don't know. I wasn't possible every week, but I was aiming for one a week. Mm. I wasn't quite getting there. One a fortnight, at least.
Can I interrupt you and say thank you that our parish was without your permission, we're going to assume that we're a favourite now, so thank you.
Wow. One off.
Feel for the poor parish that's last on the list.
Yeah.
they're not loved any less. You got to start somewhere and get to the end.
Of course.
It was important for me. I started simply because I didn't know Melbourne.
Yes.
And its surroundings and what have you. Mm. And how, if I just stayed in the cathedral all the time, how was I ever going to possibly get to know God's people around our diocese? Sure. But just simply going out has revealed an awful lot to me about where the life of the church is in our archdiocese. It's an interesting sort of reality, I think, that we've got in our archdiocese, that Melburnians generally kind of define being a Melburnian in terms of the fairly narrow inner parts of Melbourne.
Yes.
Nearly the tram track, if you think of the tram track.
Yeah,
sort of,
exactly.
Part of Melbourne. But in fact, most of our people, most Melburnians in all the various suburbs and what have you, and you know, I dare I say this, I'm going to get in major trouble by saying this, but including Geelong.
Don't worry, they're very far away from us, so we're okay.
Yeah, in terms of, hour and a half drive or so.
It's true.
They're not they. They're
worse. True. Please. Yes.
Very inclusive.
God's people in Geelong and the surrounds are part of the Archdiocese of Melbourne.
Yes.
Oh, that's true.
Far-reaching. Yeah.
So anyway, my point is that the majority of the population of Melbourne lives beyond the tram tracks.
Mm. Mm. That's true.
Yeah.
We have an image of Melbourne as something of the inner part.
Yes.
But the reality. Mm. Is on the outskirts, on the peripheries.
Yes.
Interesting that the centre of our life, of our city's life, the centre of it is at the peripheries.
Mm. Yes.
Why is that important? Who's your favourite Pope?
Oh, well, Pope Francis, yeah. Yep.
what does he keep saying?
Yes, go out to the peripheries. Yeah, that's one of his things. Mm-hmm. Yep. Go and smell like the sheep was one of his things.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Wow. And you can't know how to invite people into the life of Christ if you don't know their realities.
Realities, yes, that's true. That's true.
So one of my tasks is simply, I can't really know well the realities of people's lives because I flit in and flit out, as you know.
Yes.
You know, when I visited your parish at Doveton, you know, I was there for a particular reason.
Yes.
I was there for a couple of hours and gone.
Yep.
Yeah.
So I could hardly say that I know you. in the sense of but just being present among God's people in different places, you pick up little bits and pieces. And I think that's important.
Yeah. Can I say that when you came to visit our parish, our poor parish priest had only been assigned for a few months, you know.
It was,
Suddenly the Archbishop's coming.
however, I don't know if you told me this.
Here we go.
I already knew him from my Broken Bay days.
Oh, right. Okay.
So Father Michael Paepili was in running a retreat centre in the central coast of New South Wales.
Yes, that's right.
Part of the Broken Bay Diocese. So when I was first appointed bishop of that diocese, I got to know Michael quite well. But then he went to Mumbai. Then returned to Melbourne just before I came visiting. So I didn't know any of you, but I knew him.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Something to pull him up for when we see him next.
Very beautiful priest. We had more.
We're so lucky to have him.
He's been wonderful. And can I say thank you as well? Because I think you would have been the person to assign him to Dufton. So our previous parish priest was also a Father Michael. It was so easy just to go from a Father Michael,
Father Michael.
Thanks for thinking of us like that. Yeah.
Michael's are good. We love Father Michael Shadbolt still. And we still keep in touch with him. And Father Michael Paepili as well.
So let's broaden the conversation about the church then. So going from Melbourne to all of Australia. So you've been involved in the plenary council, and that process has been going for a little bit now, and it's extended because, again, COVID-19 has put it in its tracks. I did see that I think the council now is going to pick up, there's going to be a meeting in October next year now. I think that was officially announced very recently.
Yes, it's kind of the assemblies part of the process has been, in a sense, put off by a year.
Yep.
So we're going to be October this year for the first of the assemblies. So it's been delayed by a year.
Yep. So there was the listening sessions and the collection of all of that information, and that was a big undertaking in itself.
Yeah.
What are you hearing as an Archbishop who's part of all the, you know, who's one of the bishops of Australia? What are you hearing that Catholics are saying? I don't want to say what are Catholics asking for, but what is their sense of the church, and what have you gained from listening to the submissions that different Catholics have made?
Yeah. So what has come forward is just about everything.
Yeah.
So what I'm naming there is the reality that the God's people in Australia, you know, Catholics are like the rest of Australians. Like the rest of humanity, there is a very broad sort of census perspectives. So there's those who have strong voices of wanting to change in one particular direction.
Yep.
Those who've got strong voices and want change in another particular direction. There's those who want to say, well, what do you want to do any change for? Mm-hmm. And so on and so forth. So one of the important things about the whole process is we need to keep bringing it back to what does the Holy Spirit want of us?
Not what we want of the church.
Yeah. But how might the life of the gospel better flourish? Under the sort of structures and ways that we might develop at this time. So my sense at the moment is that there's certainly God's people wanting to account for particularly the terrible things that have happened in the life of our church, in that accounting for that, the greater living of the way of the Lord in all of that. So that comes out in terms of questions of structures within the church and how we're forming our seminarians, what's the place for all of God's people in the life of the church, not just religious and priests or bishops and so on. So all those questions are floating around in this. What the task of discernment is seeing where does the Spirit speaking to all of this,
right?
And to find those matters that need to come to the fore and to be worked on.
Yeah, wow. I'm guessing that there's some truth in all the voices that you're hearing. I guess is it? I think when I participated in one of the listening sessions, I remember the question I think was, "How can we as a church be more like Jesus?" And I think that's like you're saying, we listen to what the Holy Spirit is saying to discern that, which is really important. What's your dream for the Australian church then? What would the fully expressed Australian church look like to you? Sorry, that's a big question for a Friday night.
Friday night with pre-dinner drink in hand.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah, and you've just not spent the night. Sleep. You know, you spent the night in your car as well. Sorry about that.
Yeah. For a fully fledged church in Australia at the moment, for me, this is me, not anyone else.
Sure.
This is me. Me as a Christian. I keep finding myself going back to the Acts of the Apostles.
Yep.
It just strikes me that we're there at the moment. We're not somewhere else. We have been somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we were, you know, the church in Australia at one stage was quite strong and vibrant, and it had sort of powerful voices into society and so on. That's not the case now.
Yes.
Even though we try, I think, to try and live within that, the old ways of somehow think living the dream of, but the dream is not real.
Yeah.
So we need to go back to reality. So we can hanker after the past, but this is where we're at the moment. So. And it strikes me that it has dimensions of the Acts of the Apostles. So we're at a beginning.
Yeah.
And so what did the early church do in terms of going out? How did they go out? What did they encounter? What were the struggles? How did they resolve things and so on? The life of the church is fully alive if we are going out.
If we're going, yeah.
Yes.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm.
So that image of the first disciples leaving the upper room and just not never going back to it.
Yeah. That's a great image. Yeah, yeah, I like that a lot. Yeah. I saw a sign of hope in that kind of thing. So up until a couple of years ago, I was running the youth group at Holy Family, and one of the things we made sure to do was to attend the Australian Catholic Youth Festivals. And that was a very much an experience of bringing all these people together. So one of the priests there who had presented talked about it as that mountaintop experience. So we come here, we're filled with grace, we experience God in a way that maybe we never have before, and then we go out. And I've seen some of the graces of that, in the immediate period afterwards, with our young people. And we actually took young people who had no experience of God, but they wanted to go with their friends. So we said, all right, well, let's take them and see how that goes. And it's done some good things for them too. I think it'd be great to see a church that has a lot of that going on as well. That's a great expression.
The experience of having a relationship with Jesus, finding experiential ways that can happen along with the learning about our faith. The two need to go together.
Yes. Yes.
So I'm a big fan of things like ACYF, World Youth Day.
So Archbishop Peter, I know that you have dedicated this diocese to St. Joseph during this time of coronavirus. So, and there's even a prayer to go with that as well. So I was wondering if you could give us a brief explanation of why you chose St. Joseph, and then if you could share that prayer with us and give us a blessing as well, please.
Yeah, sure, no worries. Now, you might remember when At the very beginning of when coronavirus was starting to really ratchet up, and there was these big decisions that the government needed to make. It was on the day of his feast day, that announcements were made around we're going to close, we're going to go into restrictions and so on. So it struck me at that right at that time, then this is happening on St. Joseph's feast day. Take this providence telling us something. This great saint who knew how to live through really difficult times and challenge and not and going into the unknown and all those sort of things, but did so with his extraordinary trust and faith. So, and we know that he's a man who knew how to look after a family. Yes. Exactly. So I just thought let's hand this time over to the protective care of St. Joseph. So that's the reason why it happened.
Yeah, lovely.
And I've been saying this prayer daily for this very reason, and I'll do so until we've come out or we've got a vaccine or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. So are you happy for me to say the prayer?
Yes, please. Yes. Yeah.
Yep, definitely.
Okay. So in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Saint Joseph, you were receptive to God working in your life. Help us by your prayers at this time of trial. You kept Jesus and Mary under your watchful care. May your prayers assist our local church to respond to those in need. You taught the Christ child your trade and prayers. Help us to follow him, his example of love. You were part of God's plan for all humanity. Assist us to be vigilant and responsible this day. You spent your life in service. May we be mindful of others, particularly the elderly and vulnerable, caring for them in these difficult times. You trusted in the clear primacy of God over all history and every situation. Help us to grow in faith. And pray to the Father, thy will be done. Amen.
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 In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
And I was wondering if we could ask your blessing on those who are listening to this podcast.
So everyone, I've been talking to you lot. I haven't been talking to everyone. Hello, everyone. I hope that you're listening to this podcast. I like listening to it myself. Not only this episode. I suspect this will be the one episode I will not listen to.
We're so pleased that you listened to it.
Yes, we're grateful to have you as part of our listeners. Yeah,
thank you.
But those of you who are online, lovely that you're able to participate in this podcast. Say a little prayer for Lindsay and Carolyn and Lino and their families. For all of you who are listening, keep them in your prayers. A little prayer of thank you for the. For this work of evangelization that they're doing. And we ask you, Lord, to come upon all of those who are listening, fill them with your love and tenderness, give them encouragement where is needed, sustain them in their difficulties, fill them with joy and hope. And may Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for that. We appreciate that. So, we'd like to round out the show by thanking everyone after that blessing, thanking you all for listening to episode 36 of The Catholics of Oz. And before we go, as always, we'd like to thank some of our patrons who make it possible for us to create this show and to get wonderful guests like Archbishop Peter Comensoli on with us as well. So today we'd like to thank Warren C., Matt B., Ricardo G., Mary B., and Charles W., through their generous donations at sqpn.com/give, they make it possible for the Catholics of Oz and all of the other shows on StarQuest to continue. So you can join them by visiting sqpn.com/give. Also, we'd like to know your thoughts on today's show. Maybe you'd like to say something to Archbishop Peter through all the ways that you communicate with us. So please feel free to do that. You can do that by visiting us at the Facebook page for SQPN, facebook.com/StarQuestMedia. And don't forget that we have our own Catholics of Oz Facebook page as well at facebook.com/Catholics of Oz, spelt O-Z at the end. So also don't forget that you can also email us at catholicsofoz@sqpn.com. Caroline, thank you so much for being on the show today.
Thank you. Have fun.
Yes. And Lino, as always, thank you very much for being part of the show.
You've been really good.
And Archbishop Peter, thank you. It's been great to have you. And thank you for the work you do for the Archdiocese. And you will be in our prayers as well as we continue on down the journey.
Thank you. Good deal. That's the payment. You say a little prayer for me.
Well, agreed.
Sure.
Excellent. Thank you. Yep. All right. And once again, I'm Lindsay Sant. And thank you for joining us on the Catholics of Oz on StarQuest.